Praising you, heavens and all that's above. Praising you, angels and heavenly hosts. Let the whole earth praise him. Praise him, the sun, moon, and bright shining stars. Praise him, you heavens and waters and skies.
There is no one like you. There is no one who does the things you do. There is no other God above you and none beside you. Amen. No one who compares to you in might or majesty and mercy. You are our God and we worship you today. Let's sing together.
And all other kings are only pretenders. Their power is small. All other kings are here for a moment. But you, O God, hold the world in your hands. All creation surrenders back to our God, the invincible, the all-powerful King of glory, to our God, the unshakable. to our God, the invincible, the all-powerful King of glory. To our God, the unshakable, unmistakable King of glory. To our God, the invincible, the all-powerful King of glory. To our God, the unshakable, unmistakable King of glory. Let every knee bow down, nations relinquish your crown. To our God, to our God.
We proclaim Jesus and the power of his resurrection. Yes, you can be praised. He brings us life and the assurance of his fellowship. Listen to 2 Corinthians 9:8.
And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work.
He has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. This grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time.
This is amazing grace.
This is amazing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life, that I would be set free.
I sing.
Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. This is amazing grace. This is amazing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Let's declare it together.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
We sing worthy.
This is amazing grace. brings our chaos back into order. Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is amazing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free.
Children said,
amen. Amen.
Alone in my sorrow and death in my sin.
Lost without hope and no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began.
Amen. Hallelujah. So I want to tell you that He has not forgotten who you are. For He created you in His image for His purpose. And He is not done with you at all. You may feel that He has abandoned you. Perhaps your friends have abandoned you. Your health is turning on you. Finances are turning on you. But I'm here to tell you, the Word says, I love you. I made you for my purpose. Amen? And so we're going to sing about that. And my hope is that the Lord will reach down into your heart today and remind you that you are special for Him. I have a Maker. He for my heart. Before even time began, my life was in His hand. You know it? Sing it together.
He knows my name. He knows my every thought. He sees each tear that falls and hears me when I call.
Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. And if I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me, and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for the darkness is as light to you.
For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was wrought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. The Lord bless you. You may be seated.
It was a few weeks ago, actually 4 weeks ago, I was getting ready for Isaac and Maddie Souter's wedding. And I'm working through the message and preparing for the wedding itself. And I stumbled across some scriptures and felt really led of the Lord that the next sermon I preach, this is what I'm supposed to preach about. One another, how we're to love one another. And I was kind of excited about that, and I went out into the office, and I told the girls, I said, you know, I always struggle to figure out what I'm supposed to preach, and I'm not even sure when the next time I'm supposed to preach, but I know what I'm supposed to preach, and was excited about that, and there's a reason for that. Evidently, the Lord has something for some of you today, and it's always fun when you feel like the Lord has led you to this place. And a lot of times, you know, I'll sit down and I'll prepare a message and I struggle. What, Lord, what is it you want me to say? And occasionally I'll have this situation where I know. Well, on Monday after the wedding, pastor came into my office and said, hey, I'm going to be gone on vacation July 17th. Would you be willing to preach? I said, absolutely. I already know what I'm going to preach. I'm going to preach on loving one another. One another. And we're instructed in Scripture to submit to one another out of reverence for Christ, to forgive one another, to encourage one another. Now, it's always easy to forgive. Sometimes, you know, people do things to us, and it's just hard for us to forgive them, and yet we're instructed to forgive one another. We're instructed to encourage one another. It's not easy sometimes. Some people are incorrigible, and, you know, it's just difficult for us to be that encouragement to them. We're instructed to restore one another. And we think, you know, I'm just so busy trying to fix the things going on in my own life. How can I even think about restoring another? We're instructed in the Scriptures to accept one another. And there are some people it's just hard for us to accept. We're instructed in Scriptures to care for one another, to carry one another's burdens. And that's not always easy because we have our own burdens and our own toils and our own schedules, and it's hard for us to find enough energy to even care about or carrying somebody else's burden. We're instructed in Scripture to bear with one another, to serve one another, and of course to pray for one another. There are many one another's throughout the Scripture. But the one that kind of helped me to put this all in perspective was the preparation for the wedding. And that was found in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 21. Now the text for today is really found in Romans chapter 12. And we'll get to that in just a little bit. Romans chapter 12, verses 9 through 12. But go with me now to Ephesians 5. The Scripture says, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. You see, Christ is the key. It's our ability to submit to our Heavenly Father that enables us to love one another. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. If we simply submit to one another, we will find it difficult. You see, it's our nature to be self-centered. We want what we want. It's easy for me to be me. It's hard for you to be me. In a relationship with a spouse, it's easy for you to be you, but it's hard for your spouse to be you. And if you simply say, just submit, the scripture says, submit to me. And then one spouse will submit to the other. And then that works for a while. And then all of a sudden the marriage begins to fall apart and they don't know why it's falling apart. It's because, well, he lost the sense of his identity. She lost the sense of her identity in this submitting out of their own strength. You see, it's easy for me to be me, but it's hard for you to be me. And whether you're married or not, there are principles here found in Ephesians chapter 5 that help us in all relationships of life. And the scripture says, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. You see, it's difficult for us to get these relationships right unless this relationship is right. It's God himself, his Holy Spirit. It's the fruit of his Spirit that empowers us, that enables us, that equips us to be able to submit to one another. And so it begins with submitting to one another. It's having each other's interests at heart. The key is Christ. Christ must be central. Ephesians 5:22 says, wives, submit yourselves to your husbands as you do the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is the Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Now, if you read this scripture without context, one might simply ignore it or skip over it, or might simply say, you know, Paul was a chauvinist, and I don't want to listen to that, and miss the beauty of the words behind the scripture. Paul starts by saying, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. It's this one another, having each other's interests at heart, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. Christ is the key. Christ is our guide. And if we're careful, we're not careful, we might miss the beauty behind this scripture. When Jesus came into the world, you see, he turned our world upside down. The last would be first, and the first would be last. He came to serve and not to be served. So being the head in this context means you are the lead servant, the spiritual leader of your home. Submission understood in this context of the scripture is a beautiful thing. So we submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. I make decisions as the spiritual leader of my home that is in the best interest of my family, according to God's way. I take my family's interest at heart. I make decisions as the lead servant. You see, there's a beauty in this submission to one another. It's having each other's interest at heart. Husbands are to love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Of course, the husband, Christ, died for the church. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. I love that. I love the beauty of those words. He who loves his wife loves himself. You see, in this is a kernel of truth of how we build one another up in love, when we encourage one another in the faith, when we help each other become the people that God has created us to be, we strengthen ourselves. When I strengthen my wife, I strengthen myself. When I strengthen others' relationships around me, I strengthen myself. I once heard it was said, there's winners and winners and losers, and no such thing as winners and losers. Every time I cause someone to win, I in turn win. Anytime I cause someone to lose, I in turn lose. Now you say in the world that's not always true. Well, it may be. But for me, you see, I would rather live my life where I help those around me to win. There are winners and winners and losers and losers. And in relationships, in all relationships, we have to ask the question, are we submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ? It's not my will, but His will. Am I a servant? Am I loving as Christ would have me to love? Am I giving myself to the work of God? Or is it all about me and my self-centeredness? Husbands, love your wife just as Christ loved the church and gave Himself up for her. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated their own body, but they feed and they care for their body just as Christ does the church, for we are members of His body. You see, the beauty of this scripture is all about trust. Trust in God. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. If you trust one another, trust God and trust one another, then you find yourself where there's this intimacy in the relationship because you have each other's interests at heart. It's not a self-centered relationship. And you see how that applies to every single relationship, whether we're married or not, when it's no longer about me, but it's about Him. And how I can be His instrument of reconciliation. How I can be His instrument of love. How I can be His instrument of grace. How I can be His instrument of grace. So husbands and wives, celebrate each other. Church, celebrate each other. Celebrate each other's strengths. And support one another in your weaknesses. Allow the Holy Spirit to replace your natural self-centeredness with His fruit, the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, and self-control. So we're to submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. We're to forgive one another. We're to encourage one another. We're to restore one another. We're to accept one another. We're to accept one another. We're to care for one another. We're instructed to carry one another's burdens, bear with one another, serve one another, pray for one another. So how do we love? How do we really love one another? Romans 12, verses 9 through 12, give us some real insight on how we can love one another. Matter of fact, if you read all of the chapter 12, you'll see real clear guidance on how to love one another. Romans 12, 9 says, love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor, serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer. So, the first is love must be real. Love, the scripture says, must be sincere. It's not always easy to love some people. Some people are stinky. I remember it was 1995, a kid by the name of Ronnie. And Terry, you remember Ronnie. Ronnie came to me and said, I feel like the Lord is telling me to lead 9 of my friends to Christ. I thought, well, that's great, Ronnie. I've never known a teenager, especially a junior hire, to leave 9 friends to Christ. Well, by September of that year, Ronnie had led 9 of his friends to Christ. And we took each one of those 9 friends to through the basic Bible studies, myself and the youth staff. And I would go to pick them up at the middle school and take them to the Dairy Queen. And we'd work through Chick Schaefer's basic Bible studies. And then I would take them back home. They would join us on Wednesday nights. And the youth group was growing. And there was one kid, his name was George. Now, George smelled a little bit. You know how junior hires kind of have that stink, that little aroma. They don't really, haven't quite learned how to take care of hygiene. Well, George, this was really, really, really true of George. And he would come to youth group on a Wednesday night, and I would say, George, I have a washcloth and some soap and some deodorant and a clean T-shirt for you. Would you be interested in going in the restroom and cleaning up? And he did. He'd go in and clean up and freshen up a little bit. And I would take him home often. It wasn't long before I realized that George was somewhat homeless. I would drop him off. And he said, just drop me off here. and then just dropped me off over here, and I was wondering where was his home. And I realized his family was constantly being evicted, and he didn't always have a steady home. He probably didn't always have a steady shower, and it made perfectly sense that George smelled a little. I remember having a junior high afterglow at the house, and you know, when the kids would all come into the house, they'd all take off their shoes, and I don't know why, it was kind of a custom in this area, and they'd all throw off their shoes, and we'd have 20, 25 kids sitting around our house and playing games, and George took off his shoes, and we were sitting around the circle, and George was right beside me, and his feet just stunk. I remember praying, "Lord, help me to love George. He smells so bad. I could hardly stand it." You've got some smelly people in your life. It's difficult to love. People that rub you the wrong way. They're a little stinky. They got stuff. But you see, love must be real. It must be sincere. And if we try to love in our flesh, we will always come short. That's why this relationship with our Heavenly Father is so key to every relationship in life. As I prayed that day, "Lord, help me to love George," the Lord gave me a love for George. And I said, "Lord, help the stink to be an aroma of your grace." Fragrant to your nostrils. I watched George as he was kind of adopted into the family here at Grace Point, Lake Avenue. I watched him as Terry Wright coached him in volleyball, and he played every year on the district team for probably his sophomore, junior, and senior year of high school. You see, love must be real. Second, choose a holy life. Hate what is evil, the scripture says. Cling to what is good. How can you hate evil and be a loving person? That's a real question, isn't it, today in the world in which we live? How can you hate evil and be a loving person? It isn't easy today. So often the world teaches what is evil is good and what is good is evil. But the Bible says abhor or hate what is evil and cling to what is good. Can you do this and be a loving person? Do you even know what is evil? Let me suggest this. Jesus is the perfect picture of God and man. What he says is evil in his word is evil. What he says in his word is good. Hate what Jesus hates, sin. And love who Jesus loves, people. All people. I want to repeat that. Hate what Jesus hates, sin, and love who Jesus loves, people, all people. Red and yellow, black and white, they're all precious in his sight. This will get you off to a good start in hating evil and clinging to what is good. Matthew 7:13, "Enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many enter through it. But small is the gate, and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it." Are you guarding your heart? Are you setting up guardrails in your life to keep you from evil? What things do you linger on? Are you hating evil and clinging to what's good? Are you pouring your life, investing your life in the things which are holy and just? Are you allowing yourself to be dragged in a way and enticed by a world that's lying to us? Hate what is evil and cling to what is good. 1 Corinthians 10:12 says, "So if you think you're standing firm, be careful then that you do not fall." I think sometimes as Christians, we travel down this road and we think we've accomplished it. We're successful as a follower of Christ, and we get up on our pedestal, and we have to be careful. At least what we fall. We always have to be on our guard. We always have to protect our heart. We always have to be careful of what our mind is seeing. Proverbs 16:18 says, pride goes before destruction, a haughty spirit before a fall. But you see, Christ wants to do a work in us. He wants to transform us, and he wants to give us a new life, a new beginning, a fresh start. It may be that you've never asked Christ in your heart and your life, and so these relationships are difficult because you don't have this relationship with the Heavenly Father. It could be that you just struggle with life itself, and you need to know that God loves you and he cares for you. When Jesus died on the cross, he paid a price that you should have paid. He offers to us a new life, a fresh start, a new beginning. 2 Corinthians 5:7 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. All you have to do is ask him in your heart and life. Say, Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner, and I want your righteousness. I want this holy life that the pastor's talking about. I want to know your love and your grace and your mercy, and I want to be love and grace to the world around me. Please forgive me of my sins and give me your righteousness. And when we pray that prayer, he will do just that. He gives us that new beginning, that fresh start. A poem, two natures beat within my breast. The one is foul, the one is blessed. The one I love, the one I hate, the one I feed will dominate. Are you choosing a holy life? Are you choosing to cling to that which is good and hate that which is evil? James 1:21 says, therefore get rid of all moral filth and evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which saves you. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Hate sin. Love people. 3, cultivate a genuine affection for one another. Verse 10a says, be devoted to one another in brotherly love. The Greek word devoted means full of tenderness. It conveys the idea of deep affection. Of a family member that's often felt with family members. The Greek term here is Philadelphia, literally meaning brotherly love. Paul uses these terms to help us to see that we are to love each other as brothers and sisters in the Lord. I know it's not always easy to love even our fellow Christians, even our brothers and sisters in the Lord. Sometimes it's difficult for us. Debbie and I were in our first church and our first situation, and we had a family that was upset with us. We had a couple instances, three instances in particular, where they became offended. One, we left on time, and they accused us of leaving early for an event, and so their kids weren't there when we left, but we had left on time, but they didn't see it that way and said, no, you left early, and accused us of lying, and of course we weren't lying. I called time and temperature before I left, but you know, everybody has their side of the story, right? So I had my side of the story, and he had his side of the story, and he was upset. And then Debbie was meeting with one of the teen girls, and we had an after-school at the house, and she was going through a difficult time, and Debbie listened, and then prayed with this young lady. And then mom called, and she was upset because Debbie spent the entire evening at the afterglow with one of the girls and ignored all the other girls. And this mama bear was really, 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 really upset. And they were not happy with us. And I couldn't say, you know, my wife has spent the whole evening working through a difficult situation with one of our teenage girls that needed someone to have a listening ear and to pray with her. I couldn't say that. We just took it on the chin, and you know, they didn't like us. They even said, you know, you won't be here this time next year. And they kind of were pushing it. We felt like they were pushing us out the door, and we were offended, and they were offended, and you know, there were three things in a row, and they were upset, and we were upset. And now I remember telling the Lord, Lord, I don't like them. They don't like me. I don't like them. And the Lord said, you know, you really don't have a choice. The scripture says you're to love one another. They will know you are Christians by your love, and you don't love them. You need to love this family. And I think, Lord, I don't like them. How am I supposed to love them when they don't like me? And they made it very apparent, everybody around me, they don't like me. And the Lord was very clear, you need to love them. And I remember Debbie and I going to prayer and praying for this family. And it was interesting, as the Lord began to break down the walls that had built up between us. You know, the kids and I got along great, but it was Mom and Dad, and I remember meeting Dad in an altar of prayer, and the Lord did a work that I could not do. You see, we need to be devoted to one another in brotherly love, and we cannot do that in our own strength. It's this relationship, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. I could have chose not to pray for them. I could have chose to be angry at them. They were angry at me. I could have been angry at them. But I would have been living contrary to the will of God. And the Lord did a work that I could not do. Number four, esteem others more highly than yourselves. Verse 10 says, honor one another above yourselves. And of course, we find in Philippians a perfect example of this, where Philippians 2:3 says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but to the interests of each, to the interest of the other. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, used for his advantage, but rather he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. We need to be in the business of honoring one another, of building one another up in love, of celebrating each other's strengths and standing behind each other's weaknesses. I know each of you. Some of you have weaknesses, and that's okay. Many of you have strengths, and we celebrate those strengths, but we stand behind you in your weaknesses. Fifth one is enthusiasm. Verse 11 says, never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Now, Zig Ziglar writes that the word enthusiasm comes from the root word entheos, which means filled with the divine, God within, entheos. It's that ability to tap into a greater power than ourselves. It's ability to tap into his strength, his hope, his grace. Enthusiasm comes from this relationship with God, knowing who we are as his children, his creation. Faith in God doesn't make life easier, but it makes you stronger. I want to repeat that. Faith in God doesn't make life easier, but this relationship with God will make you stronger. Someone told Zig Ziglar that motivation or enthusiasm doesn't last. And he replied, neither does a bath. You need to take one each day. This relationship with the Lord, this strength that comes from the Lord, it's a daily taking up our cross and following him. 6, hopefulness. Be joyful in hope. Understanding who we are as the redeemed, we have joy. Understanding who we are as one who has been bought at a price, that Christ himself died so that I might live, that I might have a relationship with him, brings joy even in the midst of the trials of life. You see, there is nothing more infectious and obvious than genuine joy. Joy does not permeate your, if joy does not permeate your life, if joy does not bring laughter through your home, it's not that then perhaps that you've allowed circumstances to dictate your joy. You see, we're to allow God to work in us and through us. Now, I have to be honest with you, I don't always feel joyful. I'm kind of a stoic person. I have this reputation of not really being a hugger. And that's true. It's because I'm just kind of a stoic person. But there is this inner strength that God has provided throughout my life that brings stability and consistency. And I have to be honest with you, it's not because of my strength. It's his strength. In my weakness, he is strong. And it's the same with joy. It's that joyful hope in who we are in Christ Jesus. I'm not talking about self-motivation or joy or enthusiasm. I'm talking about real, genuine, authentic joy that comes from a relationship with the Holy God who loves us and wants the very best for us. 7, persevere in the midst of adversity and trial. The truth is, when we walk through difficult times in life, if we allow God to use that, he will make us stronger. Stronger in our relationships. When we carry one another's burdens, we begin to be bonded together. Persevere in the midst of trials. James says it this way, consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know the testing of your faith develops perseverance, and perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. And finally, devoted in prayer. Faithful in prayer. How do we love one another? How do we live our lives in such a way that we encourage one another? Well, it starts right here. That's the key. And we allow God himself to empower us and equip us to love one another. And we do that through the study of the Word of God and through prayer. It was one of the Mexico trips we had taken, a group of teens, and we were working on a foundation. The first day of work is the hardest day. We pour all the concrete, and this particular slab was a 22 by 22 foot slab, and you mix gravel and sand and cement all in a big mound, and you put a hole in that mound, and we call it a volcano, and fill that volcano up with water, and it's very intense, very hard. It's just hot and miserable, and it takes everybody's effort to mix that concrete by hand. And it's a long, long day of work. And we had gotten to the work site, and I realized that we'd filled up all the ice the coolers with ice, but someone failed to put water in the coolers, and I was worried about running out of water. And so I was kind of regulating how much water I was drinking. And I was drinking as needed, and I emptied my little cup, and I was afraid my little thermos there, and I was afraid we might run out, so I didn't get it, fill it back up with any water, and I was measuring and kind of watching as the ice was melting how much water we had, and I just kept working. I never really said much to any of the teens. I didn't want them to be afraid. You know, we run out of water, and I just didn't drink any, and working along, and all of a sudden my hands seize up, just cramp, and I mean, I couldn't open up my fingers, and it's like, ah, and it's like lightning going through my forearms, And finally, I walk over to a fence and I pry my fingers open and hold it up on the fence. And then I pry up the other hand. And I'm standing here along the fence just trying to get my hands to relax. And finally, you know, somebody, Sherilyn, brought me some water. And I drank a little bit of water. And my hands finally quit cramping. And I felt better. And I went back to work. And they seized up again. Water is one of those things that we take so for granted. And yet it is so important for life. Prayer is like water. You see, if we're going to make a difference in these relationships, if we're going to love one another, it's going to be, I left my communion cup down here. It's going to be because we have communion with our Heavenly Father. And so I want to encourage you to take your communion cup. Pull back the cellophane. Take out the wafer. And then pull back the tin part. We're instructed in Scripture to submit to one another out of reverence for Christ, to forgive one another, to encourage one another, to restore, to build up one another, to accept one another. You know, I have my own peculiarities, my uniquenesses, and yet you accept me anyway. Even though I'm kind of losing that uncanny sense of balance, you still extend your love and your grace to me. We're to care for one another. We're to carry one another's burdens. We're to bear with one another. We're to serve one another. And we're to pray for one another. But I don't know about you, but it's difficult for me to one another in my own strength. And so times of communion are significant. Because it's my acknowledgement of my desire and my need to rely upon God, who's bigger than the problems that I face. So I encourage you to take the bread, break it. On the night our Lord was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Take and eat. Lord, as we take and eat the bread, we acknowledge your body that was broken for us. You were bruised for our transgressions. And it was by your stripes that we are healed. And we say thank you. The blood of Jesus Christ, this is the blood of my covenant. Take and drink in remembrance of the blood that was shed for you. Lord, as we drink this juice, we're reminded of your sacrifice, your blood that was poured out for the remittance of our sins. You paid a price that we should pay. You died that we might live. And yet, Lord, you call us now to love one another, to be your hands and your feet, to live our lives in such a way that we strengthen each other and the world around us. To daily be a reflection of your glory and your grace and your mercy and your love. So help us, Lord. Help us to live our lives in such a way that we love, not in our strength, but in the one who died so that we might live, truly live. And we pray all this in your wonderful name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed.